Benito Arruñada from the University Pompeu Fabra in Barcelona, where he is a professor of business organization. And he's here to talk to us about his new book, Institutional Foundations of Impersonal Exchange, published last summer by the University of Chicago Press. So Benito is a multidisciplinary expert. His work crosses the boundaries of law and economics and business organization. And his talents cross the boundaries of deep conceptual thinking and an amazing talent for communication, which are very often not found in the same person. But let me just read you a few sentences from chapter 3 of his book, which explains the concept of impersonal exchange. When you buy a new computer in a store, you don't check to see whether the salesperson has the legal power to sell it. When you pay for it, you don't worry that the salesperson might keep the money instead of giving it to the store, or that the store might not pay the manufacturer. Even if the employee or the store fails to comply with their duties, you know that you will keep the computer. For you, the relationships among the salesperson, the store, and the manufacturer are almost irrelevant. I feel like that's a wonderful example of taking an abstract and potentially confusing concept and explaining it in a way that you say, well, I knew that all along. Professor Arruñada's book addresses policy, practice, theory, politics. It ranges among such important and current issues as informal settlements, illegal or extra-legal occupation of land, and whether registries, whether issuing legal title, are an effective and appropriate policy response. Or the 2010 mortgage crisis in the US, where many, many foreclosure proceedings were brought to a halt because of faulty registration, where courts didn't really know who the owner would be after foreclosure. Or questions like the US Patent and Trademark Office and its interest in speed, aided and abetted by a very motivated and aggressive patent bar, and whether this actually encourages litigation and perhaps discourages innovation. In addressing all of these issues, Benito impresses upon us that registries are far from being simple, straightforward depositories of data. They're complex, challenging, and sometimes fragile institutions. But if they are wisely designed and well-maintained, they can have tremendous benefits in encouraging exchange and promoting economic development. So please join me in welcoming Benito back to the Institute.
Thank you very much, Joan, for your kind words. It's a pleasure to be again here at the Lincoln Institute to present, in this case, this book, which is the result of many years of work, but especially the last three years and a half. Initially, the book was attempted as a thought, as a kind of compilation of articles, but of previous publications, but at the end, it was much more difficult, because filling the gaps between the papers was much more challenging than I initially thought. The book has four chapters. Three of them present a theory of what is the role of registries, focusing mainly on land registries and company business registries, but with applications also to other forms of registries, other types of registries, from intellectual property to even organized exchanges for financial derivatives, which in essence are very similar devices. Today, I will try to present in 10-15 minutes the essence of the general argument in the book, which is presented in chapter 1, and then my plan was to open the floor for discussion, I mean, to introduce the main policy questions, mainly related to land, given the goals of this institution, mainly related to land, and to open this for this discussion with the floor, I mean, interacting with you about and telling you how the book sees these issues, but also mainly discussing these important issues like universal titling, or as John mentioned, the mortgage foreclosure crisis in the US, etc. No? Therefore, as I said, the motivation for the book, initial motivation was, well, let's put together almost 20 years of previous works, papers, and also some advisory work for international agencies and different governments. A second motivation was that in this work, especially in my advisory projects, I think what I have been seeing, in essence, is a deficit in knowledge, a deficit in knowledge about understanding the role of registries. As John mentioned, registries are not very simple, but unfortunately, I think people living in developed countries, we were lucky to inherit these institutions, and very often we give them for granted. We are constantly interacting on the basis of the existence of these institutions without realizing that they are there. In essence, many of these, this happens not only with registries, it may happen also with courts, it happens also probably with much of regulation. We are so accustomed to contract in a developed institutional environment that we give such an environment for granted. As a consequence, even intellectually, these are not topics which are of interest for mainstream academia. They are not the type of topics which are, economists would say, sexy in terms of providing fame, making the author, and providing good tenure perspectives, for instance, or in providing good chances of publishing in top journals. They are boring topics. Supposedly the problems have been solved 200 years ago, 150 years ago. However, if we contemplate what's going on in reality, what we see is, well, this data I have here is, I think, the best indicator. There are claims that mortgages are only meaningful in a few countries in the world. Meaningful meaning that the fact of adding a mortgage to a personal loan substantially reduces the fall risk and therefore substantially reduces interest risk, interest rate. This means that the spread, the difference between mortgage loans and personal loans is very small in many, many countries. This, in essence, means that mortgages, even if they are contracted, mortgages are at very little value. This means that the registries on which mortgages are based probably are not functioning properly. But we also see that after decades of efforts in titling, many of these efforts have failed in many dimensions. In many cases, we see that huge amounts of money have been spent in the geographic part of these efforts, meaning map titling, mapping and photographing, which no real effect on the legal status of the rights. We also observe that after much titling, there are very little mortgages of on this land. We also see that after much titling efforts, second transactions are systematically not recorded nor registered, which could be read as meaning that the value of these efforts for the users is very limited. We also see that policies are being recommended from international agencies like the World Bank, and especially the doing business branch of the World Bank, policies which have, to say the least, a naive view of these institutions because they focus only on the administrative cost of the initial registration without paying any attention to the value of these institutions, and therefore they very often lead to policies which, instead of providing value, just, in the best of cases, reduce costs for users. As mentioned before by John, we also see that developed countries like the US have serious problems in implementing good institutions, good functional institutions in this area, and the foreclosure crisis here in the US is just a very prominent example, but there are others. If you look at the current state of the Patent and Trademark Office in the US, according to many authors, there is much to be desired. Or if we look at also the financial crisis and we pay attention to the argument that contracting in financial derivatives on the over-the-counter market cause negative negative externalities which could have been solved by having much of this trading over organized exchanges, which in essence are registries, contractual registries, well, we are finding some reason to think that this argument about deficit of institutional development, institutional knowledge, is a serious problem. My previous work has been in this area, I would say, fragmented, of course, because writing papers is a kind of fragmenting work. It's useful because you are very rigorous, but it has its own biases, and therefore the goal in making this book was to provide a more comprehensive view, and it's a problem-driven effort. It's not a model-driven effort. Problem-driven in the sense of looking at what is necessary to understand these institutions and to organize them properly. This was the admittedly too ambitious goal of the book, and this effort has relied on previous work of mine, but mainly also of many other authors. My previous work also relied on this work, and it is fair to recognize these very important contributions. Here you have some of the major authors in the area who contribute very important elements for building theories in this field. To some extent, these works also, I could say, face the same problem of being somehow fragmented. You know? These works, and also my previous work, more or less is informed by developments in law and economics, economic analysis of contracting, etc. One of the reasons why it is difficult to work in this area with respect to registries and with respect to property, it is that in the economic analysis, there has been very little, economic analysis has been paying very little attention to property. This is something that could be an important idea to take home from today, you know, that which is, look, I have, if we analyze three, maybe four, if we consider also North, these three authors, Akerlof, Coase, Williamson, also Douglas North, which is included within Williamson, well, all of them Nobel laureates. I think that all the economic analysis of contracts and even institutions comes from here. is rooted here. All these authors, with respect to registries, have something in common, that in their theories, perhaps with the exception of North, because everything can be under the North thinking, no? It must be wider, but especially in Akerlofkos and Williamson, their analysis, there is no place, there is no role for registries. In essence, because they are contemplating, and we economists have been contemplating, and to a large extent, juries also have been contemplating, with the exception of property law scholars, we have been contemplating, we all have been contemplating one contract, one interaction, one transaction is time. We have forgotten about contract interaction. In a way, this is the model we have in mind. We have two parties. Remember, for instance, the thinking behind the modeling Akerlof, the market for lemons. There are two parties, a buyer of a used car and a seller, no? And the seller obviously knows more about the quality of the car than the buyer. There is a potential for conflict, there is information asymmetry, and so on and so forth. We must solve this contractually. We might have the parties signing a contract specifying the performance of the car. If we are fortunate enough to live in a developed country, we will have a functional third-party enforcer, we will have an independent judge that, in case there is no contractual performance, will punish the seller or the buyer if the buyer didn't pay the car, etc. And this is a very simple problem. I would submit that this is the problem we have in mind. Different versions. The agency problem, for instance, is a version of this. Here, the role of the judge is limited to examining what? Examining contractual performance and to enforce. Here, registries are not necessary. Both parties will have a contract and will present the contract to the judge. And it's very simple. Also, both parties could develop private ordering arrangements to protect the transaction. For instance, the seller could be CarMax, an important firm in the US that is specialized in selling used cars. Basically, they have contracts and everything, and they specify. But in essence, they have reputation. And this reputation protects the transaction. What you don't find here is a third party. Most transactions, most economic transactions, will be of this type. There will be two contracts, three parties, and between these two parties, two contracts, sorry, there is contract interaction, there are effects. And besides the two parties contracting at the first stage, for instance, here I'm using conventional language in economics, principal and agent. We have a principal and an agent. They could be a buyer and a seller transacting on land, or an owner and a lender contracting a first mortgage. I call it originative contract. And there will be a subsequent transaction later on with a third party, between the agent and a third party. This is very general. This could be the Akerlof problem. Imagine when you are buying a used car, imagine yourself at the subsequent contract moment. You are buying from a person. You don't know the quality of the car. This is the problem in Akerlof. But those familiar with land know that you will be worried also about what? About the title of the seller. You will be worried that the seller, is the seller the owner? If the seller is not the owner, does the seller has authority to sell? You will be worried, what happens in case he has not title, he has not authority? What is going the judge to do? The decision of the judge here is different, is more complex. There is also an issue about contractual performance. Is the car performance or performing or not? Okay, about the subsequent contract. But there is another decision to be made in some conflicts. What happens if the agent had no authority? Well, the owner may ask the judge to return the car to him. Therefore, the third party should be worried not only about physical quality, should be worried also about the possibility of losing what he is buying. This is very worrying because in most circumstances, the remedies given by the judge are very different. The judge in these cases will be allocating what juries call property rights and contract rights, will be giving the car to one of the parties, to the owner of the third party, the owner of the buyer, and will be giving something else, an impersonal right, a claim for indemnity against the agent to the loser party. In most cases, the in rem right, I mean the asset, the car, the land, has much more value than the personal claim. Because in many cases of conflict, for instance, the agent probably is judgment proof, or the agent has even fly, disappeared. Imagine that these cases are cases in which there was a problem of title. There was a problem, I mean, the agent lacked proper title to sell, proper authority. Therefore, he is not very reliable in most cases. No? There are many examples of this. Just to mention some close to your interest in land policy, obviously, the double sale of land. Here you have an owner who sells twice. And there are, before the judge, they come two buyers claiming the land. But there is only one parcel of land to be given. Even worse, because it's the case of two mortgages. Even worse, harder to manage, because mortgages, also ownership, but mortgages are abstract. And being abstract, they might remain hidden. This makes mortgages very difficult to contract. In other areas, structurally, it is the same problem. Company representation, all sorts of representation. In fact, companies are even more complex, much more complex than contracting online. Because a company is a parcel of land with corporate will. Therefore, it poses additional and very serious problems, conflicts. In all these cases, I call them cases of sequential exchange. As I said, the judge will allocate rights in rem, rights in persona, and remedies. Rights in rem are usually much more valuable than rights in persona. Rights in rem are what juries, what legal scholars in the US call property rights. We economists, for 40, 50 years, have been using the label property rights very loosely. We shouldn't do it. I think we have introduced plenty of confusion in this area. In fact, if when we read an economist writing about property rights with all likelihood, this author will be, in fact, writing about contract rights, not about property rights. There is a huge source of confusion here. It's important for some, depends on the type of problem. I mean, for the issues of interest to Doug North, for instance, which is the possibility that the ruler, the state, may expropriate property, well, for this is relatively trivial. For the issues of registries and titling is essential. I mean, nothing can be properly understood if we do not distinguish between property and contract rights. And most of the so-called, the economics of so-called property rights is not economics of property rights at all, it's simply economics of contract rights. It has a essentially contractual or contractarian perspective, which is not damaging, but is simply makes it ineffective for understanding this type of issues. Well, in this context, we have two remedies. The book uses the language of rules, and given that in essence the judge will be giving priority to property or to contract, it uses the labels of property rules, contract rules, by saying, well, if the judge rules for the principal, is applying a property rule. The labels are a little bit arbitrary. If it protects the good faith, the bona fide fide acquirer, is ruling for, is applying a contract rule. Obviously, apparently, at first sight, there is a trade-off here between protecting ownership and protecting transactions. I mean, if imagine as a first approach that judges would always rule for owners. Well, owners would be very happy, they are protected. They don't risk losing their property. However, buyers would be very unhappy and would be very reluctant to purchase. Because in case there is a title problem, they will lose the property right. They will be giving only a claim against the agent. Contrarywise, if judges always rule for the acquiring third party, well, third parties will be happy, but will be willing to purchase, but owners might be very unhappy and also, interestingly, reluctant to do what? Reluctant to enter into originative contracts that may put them at risk. In a property contest, this is not so clear, but the originative contract is the one in which contractual specialization is decided. Take for a moment the reference of company representation. Imagine that the originative contract is, for instance, the appointment of a manager who in the subsequent contract is going to contract with third parties. Well, in essence, what you are defining in the unitive contract is the whole problem of separating ownership and control. But in a land context also, the unitive contract could be a leasing. You are leasing an apartment and the person leasing the apartment is going to occupy the apartment. Well, eventually, in some circumstances, he could pose as an owner and sell the apartment. Well, if third parties were always protected in rent, one could imagine that leases would be made impossible because the risk of losing the house would be very high. No? Therefore, there is a sort of trade-off, which is partially apparent only because third parties are the one becoming owners. No? If we extend the framework with future transactions and so on. In loan economics, there are many works that study this trade-off in a sometimes in a static manner. They study the relative incentives or how the incentives change by manipulating the rules, how the incentives of the third parties to look for information about title, how the incentives of the owner to protect the title change, and so on. In the book, I take a very different approach. Looking at institutions, I think that good institutions have been developed, have been designed to solve the problem not by statically optimizing this trade-off, but for producing, for changing the production function, for producing information efficiently in a way that at the end, with some cost, it protects both the enforcement of property and the rights, the transactions acquired. I mean, it reduces the transaction cost of acquiring property. It protects both third parties and owners. This has to be made by producing information to make transactions less asymmetric. The key is to provide good information for the decision maker here, which is at the end the judge, for the judge to apply the rules selectively, to apply the efficient rule. The efficient rule is either protecting the third party or the owner, but selectively. What we see in the institution, in the legal institutions in this area, is that this choice of rules is not decided by the judge. It is decided by the owner. By the owner in the originative contract. This guarantees minimum intervention. In a sense, what I am arguing is that registries and similar institutions are working, are not public interventions, but they are devices that allow the exercise of private rights, of the right of property, in a manner that doesn't increase the transaction cost at the subsequent exchange. How it is done? This sounds theoretical, but very simply. The most simple case and the first functional solution was reached in the Middle Ages in the merchant law, the law of commercial law, around the 11th or 12th century. Merchant courts decided to apply a rule protecting third parties, to give the third party, the purchaser, to give the purchaser the thing, the right in rent, when the owner, being a merchant, had entrusted possession of the movable goods to another merchant. Therefore, this entrusting of possession, and I am using, I think, the language in the Uniform Commercial Code of the US, this entrusting or delivering of possession, which is freely decided by the owner, it is the owner who chooses to whom he or her is given possession to. This deliverance of possession is taken by the court as a voluntary, I understand that, as a voluntary dilution of property. Imagine for a moment that you are selling your used car and you don't want to sell it yourself. Now, which rules do you want? Do you want third parties to be protected in rent, or do you want you to be protected in rent? I mean, you are going to hire someone to sell the car. What happens if this person doesn't pay you at the price? What is more efficient to you? Well, it might well be the case that you prefer that the third party be protected in rent, because you will have more potential third parties. And also, you are not worried about misbehavior by the agent, because you know that the agent, you chose a reliable agent. Therefore, you're not worried about diluting your property rights. The arrangement, I think, is beautiful because there is a minimum intervention. There is a problem, however. I mean, consent is beautiful, but we need to make sure that you cannot change your mind. The judge, when decided, I mean, it cannot be the case that after the fact that the agent doesn't pay you back the price of the car and the car has been sold, you say to the judge, well, no, but the rule, I mean, I didn't want the third party to be protected in rent, you know. No, I didn't want that. No. You cannot have the both benefits at the same time. You have to be committed. Ex ante. You cannot change your mind. There is a beautiful case, which is the limited liability for centuries in Europe, without registries. People were building, wealthy people were incorporating, creating companies, well, partnerships, with limited liability, but they start making business claiming, I mean, the agents were claiming that liability was unlimited. When the business was bad, they started saying, no, you know, we have this piece of paper that my liability was limited. Well, this cannot work that way. We need verifiability. I mean, we need to make sure that the content of the contract is supervised by the judge, I suppose, in case this is necessary. This is a different verifiability from the one in single exchange. In single exchange, the judge has to look at contractual performance, that has to verify contractual performance. Here, the judge is verifying contractual content, the content of the contract itself. Is this difficult? Well, in some transactions it's difficult, in others it's easy. Once the merchants in the Middle Ages realized about this wonderful device, they were slow in realizing this. The Romans didn't have something like this. It's only 11th century. This is something to think about. Even switching the rules was not easy. Royal courts at the time were very conservative. It was the merchant laws, the merchant courts, that applied this innovation. Because you might understand it is somehow contradictory with protecting property. It's a dilution of property. I mean, at the end, you are allowing a non-owner sort of to keep the property. You are dispossessing the true legal original owner. But given that here there is something visible, which is relatively visible, the transfer of possession, this is relatively public. Well, it can be taken, this information can be taken and used in the judicial process. This is not so for abstract rights. This is much more difficult, especially when you have also for assets on which you have multiple rights. If you have multiple rights, some of these rights will very likely will not be visible, will not be observable. Well, in land, an easement may be visible. Others may not be visible, not observable. But mainly, ownership and charges, mortgages, etc., are not observable. They are abstract. We might observe possession, but not ownership. Even the basic division between possession and ownership poses serious problems. That's why simple systems, which relying on possession, what they are doing is, to some extent, well, merging ownership and possession. Something to think about is that, historically, we were able to apply these rules for impersonal exchange, because obviously, if third parties are protected, are safe, exchange can be much more impersonal. They don't need to know personally the third party or the principal, etc. It's enough for them to know the asset, the land, or the car. And they know they have a direct, the judge is giving to them a direct relationship to the car, to the asset. This may stay impersonal. Well, this was possible since the Middle Ages in the merchant area by this switching of rules, but it has not been possible until very recently for other exchanges, especially, particularly for mortgages, but also for companies. It's very hard without some sort of organization, without organizing a registry or something similar, it's much more difficult to make these exchanges possible. And historically, we see this different evolution is very striking, especially when in the whole of Europe, merchants were asking the crowns, their kings, to their governments, to create registries and so on for land, for companies. Sometimes these registries, they attempted to create registries, but they failed. They were not easy to create. It was not easy to convince judges of relying on the registries, for instance, or it was not easy to organize the administration of the registries, to convince owners to register or the transactions to register. I mean, introducing these changes has been very, very difficult. I'm afraid I have been speaking, it took too long to arrive here. I'm glad to say something about policy, even if this framework is necessarily very abstract, because this is the framework used to support the development in chapter 2 and chapter 3 about land registries and company registries. Some ideas about policy that come from this general framework are, first, as I tried to say a moment ago, it's not enough to switch rules. To provide judges with the possibility of verifying the content of the originative contracts, you need some organization. Some organization which most likely will be public. Second, we might be skeptical about the possibility of providing this verifiability with the help of private parties alone. Help of private parties that these being contracts will be most likely lawyers, solicitors, conveyancers, notaries, etc. The role is limited intrinsically because they don't care for third parties. Therefore, even if they have a duty to protect third parties, they are not chosen by the third party. The third party is not even present at the moment of the originative transaction. Therefore, it is hard to solve this problem by private ordering. It is also hard to solve this problem by public organization. That's why registries have failed many, many times. Public organizations suffer many difficulties. One of the difficulties suffered by registries is that there is an intrinsic conflict between lawyers, conveyancers, notaries, versus registries themselves, because the more registries are developed and the better they work, there is lower demand for the services of conveyancers. This is why we have seen everywhere that when governments try to improve or try to create land registries or company registries, these moves are resisted by lawyers. This is why in the US, every time there is a serious proposal to reform patent law or the US Patent Trademark Office, well, the patent bar resists these changes. But this is, there's a regularity here in the, people told me recently in Australia, I was presenting the book there, and told me beautiful stories about how Robert, the difficulties that Robert Torrens, the governor creating the land registries in Australia, in some states in Australia, suffered very serious problems with solicitors to introduce the system. But the same happened in England, the same is happening right now in other countries in Europe, in Italy, for instance. And the same happened here in the US. I mean, it's not by chance that the history of land registries or land recording offices in the US during the 20th century, especially in the first half of the 20th century, has been of the type it was. In a way, the summary of this tension is by thinking, and I think the metaphor can provide a good summary of the problem, in a way creating registries. If registries work well, registries are a sort of institutional revolution, similar to the Industrial Revolution, because what the registries allow is to produce legal commodities. This is very clear in the case of organized exchanges, in the case of financial derivatives. This is a commoditization process. Obviously, this reduces transaction cost. The asset is perfectly homogeneous, and you are not worried about personal characteristics of the counterparty. You know, the transactions are very easy. This is what a well-functioning registry provides. It's a sort of industrial revolution in the institutional sphere. Well, conveyancers are not like that. Lawyers are not like that. The lawyers are provide customized services, customization. There is a mismatch here with our times. I mean, our times are times of standardized products everywhere. In a way, they are conveyances are a sort of Luddites, but Luddites not fighting businessmen, but fighting public bureaucracies. That's why they are much more successful. Third, these systems produce information essentially for judges. There are, of course, trade-offs, interesting trade-offs here about between ex ante and ex post. We may spend resources ex ante or ex post. For instance, the discussion between recording and registration in land. Well, partially it's a discussion of how much do we spend examining the legality of the originative transaction versus the subsequent transaction. There is a trade-off. I think the important matter here is to understand that there are these trade-offs, that not everything is ex ante. However, projects like the World Bank Doing Business is considering only the most limited ex ante. I mean, this is totally, in my opinion, misguided. It's considering only ex ante because it considers only cost of registering the originative contract. And besides, the only user of the system seems to be the parties alone. No, the main user of the system, in fact, is the judge. At the end, the parties. But if the judges don't pay any attention to the production of information by registries, then the whole system is meaningless, and what you should be doing is closing it down, not speeding it up. Well, these are general insights. Well, this is an example from Doing Business, precisely. I mean, the current registering property indicator is measuring the steps, time, and cost involved in registering property free of title dispute. Well, come on. They are supposed to be measuring the performance of registries. Their main task is eliminating title disputes. You cannot assume away the main function of the institution you are measuring. But besides, given that the Doing Business project also doesn't include the cost of hiring, retaining lawyers and solicitors, it includes only the cost of retaining notaries. It is mandatory to retain them. Well, it is bias in the results, and the results are false. For instance, in the US, they take New York City. No? Given that they don't consider the cost of hiring lawyers in New York, if you buy a house in New York without retaining a lawyer, any of the parties retains a lawyer, probably there will be title disputes. Therefore, their measure is totally biased. I mean, they are not truly doing what they are saying to do, and they are biased in the results. I mean, in favor of what? In essence, the common law countries. These are issues of policy that we can discuss about them. This is one, the Doing Business and how these issues are measured. It's important for policy because far from being only a measurement issue, there is policy linked to it. Another one, also for land, is about universal titling. I mean, I have doubts about how universal titling is done, but given that I have far exceeded my time, I think I better let you ask questions and tell me what you do you want to talk about. Other issues, the foreclosure crisis in the US, for instance, is a very, very, very interesting issue. There is also a lesson here, because these titling issues are often referred to developing countries. And I think that all developed countries I know, we have serious problems. I mean, the registries and so on have been there, but they are not understood. Very often they are being reformed without much understanding of what is going on. There are economies, for instance, making crazy proposals about reforming these institutions as if they were a simple product market like any other. I mention also these kind of examples, like New Zealand has a very interesting reform also. But as I mentioned, I think better if we finish with open questions. Thank you very much.
You've emphasized registries as they relate to property rights. And I'm sitting here thinking there are other kinds of registries which relate to the attributes of goods. Let me give you an example. Suppose I tell you I have a dog and the dog is registered with the American Kennel Association. And that's a registration that tells you something about an attribute. Or similarly, this is a historically certified building,
uh-huh.
You know, which it's not. Well, I'm sorry, it's in a historically certified district, but then that leads to the notion that some kinds of registries actually encumber the property rights and don't advance them. Like, this building is on a floodplain, or you own property on a floodplain, you can't build on it, which leads you to zoning and so on and so forth. And so I was wondering, how broad is your sense of registries, and does it include things like that, which are not so much about property rights, they're more about their certifying attributes of properties or animals or whatever it happens to be?
Well, property rights depends how, I think, part of the answer might depend on how we define property rights. For instance, one could think that in a registry of historical sites, that definitely encumbers the property because the owner is constrained in terms of renovation. By the way, this could perfectly be part of the land registry, of the property registry.
Could be.
Could be probably better managed. But one could say that, well, this is very similar to a mortgage or a easement or a right of way. In fact, obviously, it's not a right for the owner, it's a duty. But it's a right for somebody else. The difference is that this somebody else is the public, is everybody else, no? And here, some authors may disagree about using the label property for this, let's say, collective rights. No? Some authors are happy. To some extent, this depends on political orientation. Some authors are happy about using the word right for collectives, and some others prefer to reserve the word right for individuals. But besides the terminological divide, functionally, I think they can be fruitfully analyzed with the same framework. No? Mm-hmm. And in this case, in this example, these rights, besides the fact that they might be organized in two different registries, but this is an administrative issue in a sense, well, both of them could be called property registries. I don't know, the case of dogs may be different. It depends, because dogs are animals in general, are registered for very different purposes. Dogs may be properties themselves, not they may be, but they may be also be registered for health reasons. For avoiding externalities and so on,
it's potentially a way of codifying what would be asymmetrical information, which is, I say, this is a registered quarter horse. It's not just a horse, and so I could tell you it has great bloodlines, but then I give you a piece of paper and says, look, the people who look at this actually.
Well, this would be like a civil registry.
Yeah.
No, a civil registry for animals, not for persons,
but
a civil registry. I have very little in the book, and this is something that I would love to work more, to study more deeply. I mean, civil registries in general. Yeah. I have a few pages, but because it's, in essence, a question very important for development with respect to civil registries is, should we invest in civil registries before or after land registries? I think it's my preliminary conclusion is that probably we should first invest in civil registries, not only civil registries, but technologies allowing to identify individuals. Mm-hmm. This comprises registries, civil registries, but also addresses, for instance, that allow you to locate individuals. I think this is more basic, because if you are registering land, you are registering also owners, and you need to identify the person. Besides identifying persons, this is partially contradictory with the spirit of the book, but identifying persons allows the economy, economic agents, to develop personal exchange. Mm-hmm. I mean, once you have persons identified, you can, for instance, open bank accounts. And there are some initiatives, maybe South Africa has been well studied, for instance, that opening bank accounts have been terribly useful for, if I can use the word, formalizing people. I mean, for bringing poor people into the market economy. It might be, it's based on some registries, because what is happening is that once you have a bank account, the bank, it's a private registry, that's why it is personal. The bank has a credit record, I mean, a bank record, knows your transaction, knows how much money you are doing, and so you develop as an individual a reputation, and at least there are some studies that that say that this, and it's insensible to me to think that this might be useful. It has an advantage, which is that civil registry probably is much easier than a land registry. It's not so conflicted, because in a land registry, especially if you want to clear title well, you might need to do plenty of legal work, and you might also make many mistakes, depriving people of some rights and so on. In a civil registry, this risk is more limited, therefore it is easier, low cost, more effective. And what you do, I mean, what the state is doing is empowering private parties, I mean, entrepreneurs, banks, etc., to start doing another type of activities, you know, that are very useful. This is a sort of registry which is, we might say that it's also a property registry, because, individual, it's owned by itself, but it's a registry. But it's, I think it's better considered as a different species, no?
Let's talk about the trade-off. You criticize the World Bank and its approach for looking only at the question of the minimal cost and minimal time to register, mm-hmm. in terms of the actual first party, and not paying enough attention to what the registry has to do in terms of producing information for the judge. What are the other factors that you would weigh into the equation? If I were a developing country trying to decide, should I in fact attempt to put into place a full civil law registry that's going to guarantee to the judge that I've got absolute property rights? You know, what are the factors that go into that?
I think of course, it's very difficult to evaluate what is the demand for new institutions. And in these evaluations, there are plenty of private interests. It's not only, also in the reforms.
Sure.
Suppliers, for instance, of new systems, etc. I think I would like to do some work analyzing more, and in the book I have a few examples of how market signals and contractual signals could be used to ascertain this demand. Let me give you an example. If mortgages are impossible, because there are no registries, in Imperial Rome, mortgages were possible, but not very useful. Well, what parties rely on were on what they call fiducia. What they did was to sell the land with a contractual clause that by paying you back the price, you had to give me back the land.
Yes.
Transferring ownership. Well, I think it would be possible in a country, in an area, to survey, to analyze how much prevalent these and other similar palliative contractual practices are being used. If they are no use, even if you create a perfect registry, probably there will not be mortgage loans. And this is what we are observing in many places.
Yeah.
This sort of market signal has an obvious advantage, which is that people, because if you ask people, do you need a better title, they would tell you yes, especially if you are not asking how much they will have to pay, or if you are giving the title for free. I mean, there is no information in that. But if they are entering into these transactions, well, that's really valuable information, no? Because there is an implicit demand for a better institution, because a fiducia is very, very bad, because in essence it switches the risk. I mean, the lender can sell the land, for instance, and it's an example. But there are other examples, no? Mortgages, for instance, I mentioned, they can be evaluated. How good a registry is or not can be evaluated by looking at the price of mortgages. Or repossession time. If mortgages take very long, well, this might be caused also because the courts are inefficient, it might be lost because the law is very protective of borrowers. But this thing is equal. One of the problems with mortgages is that if the registration system is poor, well, at the time of foreclosure, you need to clear title. You need to examine, and this takes time.
Well, first, thanks for a very interesting presentation.
Thank you.
Since I haven't looked at your book, I think I was sort of slow on the uptake on one point that you said was completely critical. And so this is my first point. I'm hoping that you will elaborate a little bit, but the difference between property rights and contract rights, I don't think I quite get it. So that's the first thing. The second is I'm trying to think of the ways in which increasing commerce over the internet could both help with registries, but maybe put pressure on registries. Because I would just think that as less and less commerce is personal, where you have trust in an individual, or mm-hmm. could check, or there's reputation effects, mm-hmm. and more and more commerce is across state lines, people in different countries, completely and totally impersonal.
Yeah.
I would think that it could strain registries, or like if different states have different mortgage practices, you know, it could make things difficult, but on the other hand, perhaps things are improving automatically to take.
Yeah. Well, this internet, changes related to the internet are very interesting, no? But I don't know if it's so impersonal or personal, because, for instance, eBay, but also some previous enterprises were very careful from the beginning to develop personal registries of traders. eBay, in essence, is in the business of registering personal reputation. Because traders on eBay are given the possibility of, I am not a user of eBay, but I understand that you can build your reputation there, and therefore other traders give you a grade, and then you have a better reputation. Therefore, eBay provides a sort of registration of reputational assets. Then when you have this reputation, when you enter it, I mean, you are not anonymous, because eBay is keeping track of your previous transactions. It's a very interesting mix of how this registration of reputation is making, in a way, transactions functionally impersonal, no? But by registering a personal element, formalizing a very personal element, which in our daily transactions is informal. I mean, when we know each other, we know this person is reliable, this person is not. In essence, what eBay is allowing is something similar, but between millions of traders. It's somehow similar to the issue of the banks in South Africa, because this is traditional how people, merchants, for instance, have been used reputation. I mean, they ask for reports to their lenders. If I am selling to another merchant in Alabama, I will ask my bank. My bank will ask the bank of the buyer in Alabama, is this person pays regularly and so on, and this information will come back, then I send the goods, etc. I've been so in corresponding, between correspondent banks. Your first point, let me use a slide. You have an owner who sells, because the arrows are not transactions, are agency relationships. No? The owner sells to a first buyer and then to a second buyer. The judge could give the land to one of these. In essence, he's giving a property right to one of the buyers and a contract right to the other. The person receiving the land has a right in rent. The person receiving a claim against this fraudulent owner, this fraudulent seller, is given a contract right. The possibility of claiming an indemnity from the seller. This is the essential difference. The most simple way of understanding.
Is there room in that, or what is the effect of super compensatory sorts of remedies in that story? In other words, rather than a choice simply between getting title to the property, the right in rem, or a sort of contractual right, is there not also the possibility of, as you mentioned fraud, is there not also the possibility of a remedy that will either seek to make up for any missed compensation that you get along the way, or that would deter
in theory,
sales of the same land?
I think in theory we can imagine think about specific situation in which these arguments are important. But I can say two things here. The first is that, and this is important if you are interested in reading something in the book. In the book there is an effort to examine the common transactions. The 99% of transactions which are really the essential in the economy, and also the most essential solutions and institutional solutions. Therefore, there are many of these, for instance, theft. I hardly analyze anything about theft because I think it's of secondary importance. It's important, but it's secondary importance. Okay? Another reaction to your point is that in the general case, I think this would be of second or third importance. Because I am worried in the case, as I said at the beginning, my main worry is that this guy, the seller here, will be judgment proof. The seller will be in Brazil. I think this is the real worry of the third party, in this case B2. That's the real worry in exchange. The real worry of T is that remedies on A, personal remedies on A, of any sort, are relatively ineffective. Let's use it, the way I am implicitly using in the book is on a general assumption. I probably should have been more explicit about this assumption in the book because of comments like this that I am receiving.
many of your remarks really resonate with me, but especially about the market signals on mortgages. My specialty since the 60s has been something called mortgage default insurance. And I worked decades in the US and made a lot of assumptions, and things worked pretty well. And in the 90s, I began going to developing countries to, often sponsored by the World Bank, to evaluate whether home ownership could be promoted in these transitional economies by guaranteeing home mortgages. And initially, I naively went in thinking my job was to help develop a program, help price the risk, and after the first two or three countries, I eventually ended up going to 15 or 16, I began to see a pattern that it was much more basic, kind of peeling the onion back, way beyond can you make a mortgage, but into the issues that you're talking about here in terms of property rights and foreclosure and registries. So my work product ended up developing a pattern, almost scoring a country on these basics, to the point, what do you need to do to get to the point where you can even have a mortgage system, let alone a third party contract guaranteeing that these mortgages will work and therefore, you know, make the market go. And the big question is, can you simply foreclose, and what do you get after you foreclose? And a pattern that I saw was that a country might go through where they would pass a model foreclosure law, a so-called model law, if they didn't have one. And then that still wouldn't answer the question. They would have a test case where they would run the case through the courts and and then want to say, see, it works. And what almost inevitably seemed to happen after that, especially in countries with a federal system of state, local court jurisdictions, was the banks still would say the model didn't really matter that much because local judges, tribal or whatever other connections there are, will always go for the borrower. And I ended up kind of, in many cases, saying, how do you can't really price this. It, you know, it doesn't work unless you can even get around the as you're talking about, how the judge reaches a decision. I don't know if I have a specific question about that, but whether there's a way out of that box. I mean, many foreclosures can go.
Not the insurance, I think. Because insurance, years ago, it was very interesting. I was asked to, not to advise, because it was only, I mean, it was totally some interviews and some exchanges, no? But I was studying title insurance at the time. And there was a company from London, some American interest, trying to sell title insurance in Spain and France. It was very interesting to see how difficult it is to start a business in insurance, because the pricing of risk is. And both France and Spain, well, the courts are or were relatively reliable and so on, but even there, understanding the risk which were being insured was very difficult, very, very difficult. No? But at the, more or less at the same time, I got in touch with people in the title insurance industry which were trying to sell or to introduce title insurance in Russia. No? It's similar because there you cannot, I mean, there is no a record of judicial decisions, even worse than that. Probably the judicial decisions might be modified if there is someone, especially an American firm, providing insurance. Therefore, this transplant of insurance, I think, is the most difficult transplant, institutional transplant, that even if it's in the market, but it assumes the institutions. It's harder than transplanting the institutions itself. It's harder than, for instance, less developed American courts in Azerbaijan. No? It is much more difficult if you have a city court to transplant title insurance there, or mortgage insurance, because with foreclosure, it has similar features, I think. No?
It's worse because you're and my question was usually, can the government, like the FHA, do it here? It wasn't even a private insurance question as much as public policy, and can the government...
Governments, there is some lesson in Europe from mortgage enforcement, which is the following. For a time, mortgage lending, I think also in Germany, but clearly in Italy and Spain, mortgage lending was made by either public banks or savings banks, a sort of mutuals. The type of banks that in Spain has been bankrupt in cajas. No, but at that time, in the 19th century, I think that the fact, at the time of the judicial decision, at the time of foreclosure, at the time of this acid test of the system, if the judge is going to evict the owner, the borrower, especially if the borrower is somehow a farmer, or is poor, or is evicting the family, at that time, it might help that the lender has some non-profit feature. Of course, it wouldn't help if the lender is a state-owned firm, because in that case, this is the situation right now in Spain after the nationalization of these banks. Because, especially after nationalizing losses, some people say, well, if you have forgiven the lender, now forgive the borrower, which is naive, but but having some non-profit element may help. I think in the, I don't know if in the public relations or in the political economy of the case. No? But this is a serious problem. I mean, you have this problem here with mortgage foreclosures. You had the same issue in the 30s that many states in the US adopted mortgage moratorium laws. Therefore, it is not strange that we see this this happening in countries with no tradition of mortgage foreclosures. It is not strange. I mean, this is another reason. I mean, how to evaluate this in a titling project? Even if there is demand for mortgages, how far should we go? In terms of ascertaining if at the end mortgage foreclosure is going to be or not viable.
You were talking at the outset about the signal being the spread between a straight credit transaction and a mortgage transaction as a measure of the value of the collateral.
The value of the registry.
The registry, which is almost the same as they're being collateral. One of the other interesting measures might be where there is some kind of a mortgage system, at what point does a bank, from smaller loans to progressively larger loans, find it worthwhile to make a mortgage versus a straight credit, because the small loans don't justify the extra cost?
Yeah, let me make a comment on mortgages. And that is, I haven't done this for a long time, but my guess is there might not be a lot more than 25 countries where, if you went and looked at the financial market, where you'd find the ability to sell a bond more than 2 to 5 years term. And I mean, I've always thought that although there's a set of title and foreclosure issues that impede the mortgage market, there's also a big problem about financial maturity. And if you're in a country where the government finds it impossible to sell a bond with a 10-year term, you know, don't expect mortgages to be highly available either. So these two things go, I don't know if they go together or not, but the sophistication and maturity of the financial market has a great deal to do with the presence of mortgages.
No, to some extent they should be, but what should be observed is that even for shorter durations, mortgages should be viable. But this is obviously another consideration, another factor.
to what extent does a registry have to provide standardized information? The specific question is, do you know of any registries in the world where, in effect, you can choose the level of protection that you buy?
Yes and no. Implicitly, there are many cases in which you choose the level of protection. In many cases, registration is voluntary.
Yeah.
No, there's nothing to. Also, many registries provide, for instance, two ways of accessing the registry, which is, I think, is useful. One is registering possessory rights with some low cost possibility. I mean, people register their possessory rights, and then they have to wait for 12 or 15 or 20 years if nobody challenges that. This possession, this registered possession, is upgraded into ownership. Also, there is a tendency which I think is very useful for, but usually conveyancers resist this tendency. And registries are not very fond of it because it causes some work to them. But with computers, it is possible for registries to do much more disintermediation. For instance, it's perfectly possible for, in the book I tell two different stories in England and Costa Rica, that they are market stories, they are market signals, in a way that support my argument. I tell you a story. In England, there is a possibility of registering. In England, if something happens in your house, the register doesn't tell you anything. There is a typical fraud in England for retirees that have a house in the south of Spain or the south of France, and they move there in winter. And when they come back, it turns out that their house has been sold. A mortgage. So. Therefore, market opportunity, there are no market failures, but market opportunity. The market opportunity is a law firm in London has a business of, they tell you, we sell you protection. The land registry, Her Majesty Land Registry doesn't protect you. We will protect you. We will register, I don't remember exactly the details, but we will register a caveat, something. So that if there is any other change in the register will have to tell us, and we will tell you. And this way, if somebody tries to sell, we will know. Costa Rica, probably for different reasons, but there is a private firm that daily does something similar to the title insurers here. They copy the register. Not the whole register. They copy all changes happening in the register related to their clients. And therefore, it's more or less the same. No? Well, this could be provided by registries very easily on a voluntary basis, making charging an additional fee or something, but saying, well, you have this piece of land registered, your residence. Do you want to be notified by SMS or by email if there is any change? Asking what? Asking your consent to do any change. Or at least providing information of changes. I mean, this is very simple. It's not. But this, I think the market presence of these two initiatives in England and Costa Rica gives you another beautiful example of what I was referring at as using market signals to inspire institutional changes. Mm-hmm. No? Very, very easily, and evaluating, obviously, how many people are affected, what is the cost, etc. But we have some people paying for this service. No?
In Poland, there's a thriving, unique, perhaps insurance business written by private companies to cover the delay between real estate closing and the valid registration, and just that temporary.
Puerto Rico, title insurance in Puerto Rico has in essence been used for two reasons, because some of these mortgages are sold in Wall Street and therefore need title insurance, but also because the registration in Puerto Rico took at some point 4 years. Therefore, the gap is substantial.
Gap insurance.
Is there any other question? Let me add something that might be useful, given the questions and so on. We will be holding online discussion and online symposium on the book, starting January 1st, in a website which is called Organizations and Markets. I mean, this is still preliminary, but if you send me an email or just give me your email, I will make sure that you receive some information about this. That, I mean, you are, of course, cordially invited to participate and to comment. You know, it might be, given the, thank you for your comments, because it has been very productive for my own development of my own ideas, your points. Thank you.
Well, I think you see why we were so glad that Benito came back to join us and why we need to bring him back more often. So please join me. Thank you.